right, so we're in Sweden. And this is the studio. This is the rental car.
Yeah, we started off this morning in Gothenburg. Yeah, I went and took Sherry to the hotel, got some groceries. It's 4:30 or almost 5, and I'm already tired. We haven't even gotten started yet. It's day one of Transatlantic 5.
Look who's here!
Mr. Stolt.
Are you recording us?
Yeah.
I swore it off. You're on Facebook Live right now, right?
Yeah, right.
Nearly 6 years. Yeah. Has it been 6 years since Kaleidoscope?
Possibly. Sounds right. Yeah,
5 years. Well, how does it feel?
Good. It's been good.
Tell me, how does it feel?
What's good about having the time is that we've all been able to, you know, have come up with really strong ideas. Not that I had a lot of time for my ideas, but just having the brain space to come up with them.
Go for it. Yeah.
We take what we've got and we whittle it down to the ideas that everybody likes and where we think we might plan to use them. And then we just work from there. And, you know, the music can go anywhere and it's a great vibe.
I mean, generally, I think it's always nice if we can find a few themes that comes back. I don't necessarily think we need or we should do like The Whirlwind, which is like a big piece of music, could be, but it could also be a couple of shorter, whatever, 11 minutes, 8 minutes, 17 minutes. But I think it's nice if themes from the beginning of the album comes back in some, that makes it a concept.
I always like it.
I guess I've come to a place in my life where, like, when I first started writing prog stuff, I just kind of freely associated, you know. It was like this sort of stream of consciousness stuff, as you know, as far as musically and lyrically. And then really that demo that I did is kind of like that. It's like just, you know, kind of going from one thing to another willy-nilly. And I do better, I think, to me it helps me to know what I'm writing about.
And also, in a way, I don't know if it shows in my demos, but I have lots of music. I try to pick the stuff that wasn't typical Roine. So I try to actually pick stuff that sort of was more of a challenge, more of something I hadn't done with my bands, or we haven't done in this band. Just to push it a little bit to be different.
Well, here we are in Sweden. What's the name of it? Varnhem?
Varnhem. It's a small village, actually.
I'd say.
It's not even a city. It's a village in the middle of Sweden, somewhere between the two big lakes.
This is my first time ever recording outside of America. I don't know about you, but this is my first time ever. Well, actually, we should probably say we're not recording here. We just used this session for the writing. So, you know, we gathered here on Roine's turf, in the Swedish countryside to write this album. And this is the most amount of time we've ever spent writing an album, I think, because in the past we might have five days a week, 10 days, but that also included tracking drums and other things. So this time we used like all 10 days just to write, but then again, this is the longest album we've ever done as well.
Is there any way you can get a clever way to get the melody of that into this, what's coming up now? If you open your mind, is there a way you can actually not think?
You mean on the Yessie thing?
Yeah.
The
six to five thing?
Yeah.
Sure, you could play like something over that.
Yeah.
Or something. Yeah, I mean that could happen.
But did you even present what you wanted to present?
No.
It got preempted.
No, let's see, so that's where we are, right? So that's where we are, and we're going to, is it F sharp the thing?
Sound. There's a lot of parts that we'll start playing. And it's like, oh, that sounds like Transatlantic.
Yeah, it's funny, isn't it?
It started as just like a project, but you know, here we are 20 years later, and it's like a band with a sound and a style.
What if there's a harmony on top of what I'm singing there? What would be? Into the morning. What would be like a fifth on top of that, or third on top of that?
Probably in the writing and the playing, I think.
Yeah.
So even if we wrote these songs and someone else played them, it would sound different.
Mm.
So I think it's half of it is in the writing and then it's in the playing. Things we can't get away from, even if we want them.
Right.
Lucky us.
We'll be right back.
I think of Transatlantic and a lot of bands actually as being sort of like a kettle of soup, and you put the ingredients together and it's always a really, really cool, interesting taste with Transatlantic. And right away you can feel that flavor when we get in the room to start playing. It's like, oh, it sounds like Transatlantic.
Yeah,
it's great. And so we've really found some real magical moments on this one.
Very hard for Roine and I to get work visas to go to America and record at Neal's, which I would have preferred, I think. And in hindsight, it probably would have been a quicker process.
The reason we ended up recording the backing tracks in Sweden this time is the fact that it's getting more difficult to get into the United States for Europeans, me and Pete. And we've been there four times now recording the first four albums, but this time we were sort of forced to find a studio in Europe to be sure that we could meet up and write and record this album. So we ended up in Sweden in a studio in Varnhem. It's like pretty much in the countryside, you know. A great studio, great facility, and that's the place where we did write and assemble this album.
Well, basically, it's because of Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Because these guys couldn't get into America, yeah. With them because it's become much more difficult to get into America, and so... And also, some of us wanted to try, you know, mixing it up, trying something different, and so... Here we are in the beautiful Swedish countryside.
Yeah.
You know, in order for us to be truly transatlantic, we had to record on the other side of the Atlantic. You know, exactly. We've done four albums on the west of the Atlantic, so now we needed to record on east of the Atlantic to be truly transatlantic. Now we finally are, 20 years later, truly transatlantic.
Yeah. Yeah, my take on that is, as nice as it is to do new things and to, you know, present ourselves with something that's new and exciting to us, we don't want to make an album that the fans are going to go, oh.
No,
I wasn't expecting this, you know, and, yeah. And having to kind of...
Given what they...
Yeah, we got it without, you know. Yeah,
it's about finding the balance between surprising a bit and then being familiar. You know, you have big epic themes coming in that will sound like transatlantic.
I think maybe the surprise element needs to be just new flavors.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think I don't think we could have an album of, you know, 8 or 10 short songs. I think it would just people be... But I think, like, you know, I think it still needs to be big pieces, but maybe just the things we do can be different.
I want to do what everybody feels to do, you know? So I'd be really looking to you guys to, you know, see what your inspiration is and what you're feeling, because I don't know, that's just, it seems like that's why we're here, you know.
Hey.
That's all I got.
Maybe 5 days in that I said, okay, now I see what we're doing. Because I think normally in the past, we'll have a discussion before we start. Is it going to be like Bridge, a bunch of big songs like Kaleidoscope was, or Whirlwind as a concept? And this time I remember, like, I don't think any of us had a clear, definitive direction. I think we were like, let's just start writing, you know, maybe conceptually.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, that I think that would be the right move. Yeah.
I mean, you can find chords, minor chords, but the melody is still the same.
Yeah, or close. Yeah,
close,
yeah,
or
yeah.
Close.
Yeah.
I think, and we should listen to your piece, we should listen to everything at some point, but I think there's only one or two big themes, right? I think we need some more themes. We need some more melodic themes, because that's like one of the big transatlantic signatures, I think. And I hear, like, you know, the one that plays on the outro of yours,
mm-hmm.
and it's introduced early on, and I think it has another appearance.
Yeah, it appears a couple of times.
But that's the only kind of big theme in the whole piece. Is that correct, or is there two?
There are some others, but they don't repeat.
Right.
Say that. bed right now, guys. I'm like, oh, I forgot to pitch them this idea.
It's never over.
But I'm literally going, because we never, I had the idea this morning for the da 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 in the shuffle. You know, we have the shuffle part. I forgot.
Well, there's so much six feels on this album, you could toss it on top of one of them.
Lasse, plug us in.
Right, plug us in. Wait, we're not done.
I'm in the car, guys.
We'll phone that one in.
I felt, for me personally, the last 15 minutes of it was the part that I liked the best. That felt fresh, that felt, in some way, it felt more exciting.
Together in the studio?
With great difficulty. Well, sometimes, and then sometimes it's a breeze, right?
Yeah.
Like, you find times where you're just like really struggling with a section and you know, not agreeing, and then other times it's just like, that's really interesting. You know, you'll hit these kind of roadblock areas where there's all this trouble and you think, man, are we gonna even finish this thing?
Yeah.
Right, where are we at here? And then you'll hit a, like today, I don't know, we just kind of went, okay, well, we're done. Are we really done? Oh, I get, we're done.
We were nearly done. And then you asked us to just try something else, and then we were done a little bit more.
Nearly, we're always nearly done. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's done until it's actually, the physical CD is sitting in somebody's hand. Yeah. And even then, it still doesn't feel done.
Right.
Like, you know,
we'll fix it in the live version.
Even with the whirlwind, we still have to add things in, like live. You know, Boba Fett came back. Finally, right. You know, so it's never done.
Let's try it again. We'll be right back.
feel great about the Transatlantic catalog, you know. I think there's a lot of really great stuff in there that I still enjoy playing, I still enjoy listening to. There's a energy about it, there's a freshness about it that I always enjoy, and yeah, and it's great to get back together and feel that again, you know, feel that energy and excitement and the different flavors coming together, man. It's just right there. It's like we never left.
Getting together, it's pretty much business as usual. We don't have a big plan. What's it gonna be? It's more like we're listening to demos and see what parts we like, and have this whiteboard where we write songs. Mike liked that kind of thing. So we're mapping it out as we go and building the music, you know. So I think none of us knew that we were gonna make a double album this time. It just happened that way. There was lots of material, you know. I remember sending out at least 1.5 hours, and I think Neal had a 50-minute song, and Pete had stuff, and just a lot, you know. So and we're all different. I mean, the way we work, I like to spend a little bit more time thinking about things, arrangements, you know, and some of us are quicker in the studio and having opinions, shaping opinions. I like to sit back and think a little bit. But I mean, in the end, it all works out, you know, and I think the combination of the four of us is like what makes it Transatlantic.
I'm noticing a certain discrepancy on the arrangement board. Now, this shows kind of like everybody's demo contributions. You know, Neal had all those, and the red checks are what we used. Roine brought those in, and we used those red checks. Pete brought in those. Wait a second. Hey! What's going on there? Do you not like the demo I sent in? And then at this moment, this moment in the making of it video, you need to insert my demo of what I really wanted on the album. And I don't see a red check next to it.
Well, do you know what we're going to do? I'm going to tick it now, and we're going to resolve that later.
I think that might have to be reserved for the bonus disc.
It's not about getting your stuff on an album. It's about the album being strong, you know, and the best it can be, really. That's how I've always approached music. So we did that. We had a lot of fun doing that. We always have a lot of fun. We always have a really good time. The question is, if Roine's soloing, does he want a solo over all the key changes? Or would you want to simplify it slightly, or would that be worse?
No, I mean, it's nice to have something to solo over. I mean, not like just in one key.
Yeah, sure.
So that's nice.
I mean, I think it'd be cool.
Do we need to decide right now? Maybe I can figure out something that's almost this, similar, but I can figure out some nice chord changes.
I think this is a special band. I think the personalities are very different in a lot of ways, but I think when you put us together, the music is magical. I remember feeling that from day one, from the very first Cynthia album. I remember, like, you know, All the Above and My New World, and it's like, man, this is amazing stuff. Like, what a great combination of styles and playing. It's a great chemistry, you know, and it creates, I think, some magical music. I think every one of these albums that we've done are very special. You know?
Yeah, really.
Yeah, I appreciate it more now, I think, than I did when we did it. Like, I have on my phone, you know, on the app, I have all this, and I find myself gravitating, like I think I mentioned, like, I've been listening to My New World and really enjoying the space of it.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know, I enjoy this stuff very, very, very much. So I guess I've become a fan too.
Ladies and gentlemen, Trans-Pacific, the world's worst transatlantic cover band.
Transatlantic, I would say it's we're kind of the Forrest Gumps of Prague. It's the recording is always like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. You know, we just go in there. You know, with yes, we go in with music, but we haven't decided beforehand exactly what to record. I'm sure each and every one of us have an idea and hopes or fears. But I think pretty much the writing or the construction of the Transatlantic Beast happened in the studio while the four of us are there.
I think it could be really cool, actually, to build from what you were just doing to that.
Well, we can check it out.
Hey, we've gone twice as long as the Beatles.
Yeah,
I know. It's amazing.
Now that's pretty crazy.
Yeah. Well, I realized just recently it's a long time, but as you said, it's also the time in between the albums. So I see it as Transatlantic 1, and that's the two first albums, and then Transatlantic 2, and that's the... And you realize also that you're getting older.
Yeah.
We're all getting older. I heard complaints about, oh, I'm so tired, etc., etc. It's...
Yeah.
Well, that's true. When we made the first record, I guess I was in my 30s.
30, you were... I
was
even remember
you. 32, I think. Well, now I'm 52, yeah. So, I mean, we've gone through... 3 decades. I mean, being together 20 years puts you in 3 different decades. You know, we started in the 90s and the 2000s, 2010s, and so next year would actually be the 4th decade of the band. But that means our ages as well, you know.
Yeah.
First album, I was 30, you guys were in your 40s, now I'm 50, you guys are in 60s, so time flies. Until this moment, I haven't had a clear-cut vision of what this album should be. Is it a bunch of, you know, 15-minute songs, or is it one 80-minute song, or what is this? Is this going to be Whirlwind, or going to be Bridge Across Forever? And I think now that we've actually come to this crossroads, I think I have a vision of what we should do. I think it should be something like The Whirlwind, where it's a from start to finish album, mm-hmm. but broken into bigger chapters. I mean, I guess it's not too different from Great Adventure, you know, like a 20-minute chapter,
right, yeah.
30-minute chapter, you know, maybe there could be a small one or two. But I mean, this moment here is definitely the ending of, I guess, probably this big giant chapter that we've started with.
It's pretty long.
Yeah. I mean, we might even be
Well, we haven't even done the overture yet.
Right. We'll have the overture tale in the beginning, and we might, this last bit, starting with the Roine escape thing and the drum thing, I mean, that to here could be one chapter. But this definitely feels like we're in the middle of the album now, you know? Mm-hmm. So now I'm feeling better. I'm feeling like we have direction and a course.
Good. Me too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, just trying to get it all to come together, it's a challenge, because we don't really have time to, like, you know, write all the words and things now, so I'm really leaning on the Lord to put us in the right direction. It's all going to be really good in the long run, because it's hard to tell at this point. Yeah. But I feel good. I feel good about what we just did.
Yeah, for sure. We seem to be alone, Mike.
Yeah, well, at least you and I are in sync here. Hopefully the other guys agree. Not that they have a choice, but, you know.
Not that we ever do.
I mean, in a strange way, it doesn't feel, I mean, generally speaking, I think it doesn't feel, I don't feel any difference creating music now than 20 years ago. And it's the way we're creating and the way the music is coming together, I think it's basically the same. Mm.
Yeah.
It's because of the four characters of the band, you know.
It's, I think it's Sunday night, day 5 or 6 or something. And I'm trying not to wake my wife up. It's like 4 in the morning, 4:30, I think now. Anyway, I had this idea for a closing where all four guys would sing different things from the album.
I can also picture this, like, maybe starting this next chunk, like maybe with on strings or something, you know?
Well, and if I think it's better to sing over in that way.
Right, so maybe what if we...
Whenever that happens.
Right, exactly. Play it this way when it's introduced, but then once we start singing, we can change it.
Okay. Make it so, Captain.
Could you give me those chords?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
G minor, E minor.
E minor. E flat.
E flat, yeah.
A. C sharp.
Yeah.
This When I Was a Little Boy thing? Yeah.
I was hearing some acoustic breakdown, and there it is.
I like this song.
Yeah, and I
it's the right spot for him.
I like the song too.
See,
I think it's definitely.
No, it wasn't in that. I didn't know if you guys really liked it.
Yeah. Oh no, I did.
See, you don't have. Do you guys remember when every time we came to that, it was like,
so you think you're in control? That another gloomy day unfolded.
We'd always go, woo, Count Chocula.
Right. Sure. That obviously went over my head.
I'm just losing it. Sorry.
Oh, you think?
So here we go. This is Neil's list of ideas and demos, or at least the. Even more were submitted. These were the ones that we kind of put on our to-do list, the ones that we liked, and Roine's and Pete's. I submitted a demo, and, you know.
Man, he was snubbed.
Yeah.
And then the list of the stuff we wanted in the overture, but a lot of red checks. So you could see we did get around to utilizing most of the stuff we wanted, but a lot of stuff here without red checks as well.
Yeah.
So.
Look who's here.
Sunday in Sweden.
Yeah. Back at the square where we were. Look, hey, this is where I bought my coat. Are you guys?
Yeah, I like this.
There it is. There's my coat from the video shoot.
Want to get another one? Want to get matching coats?
What, like the Beatles?
Like the Beatles.
Well, you know, there's a store here in Sweden, and hey, look, who's there? And who's in here?
Oh, look, it's Mike Portnoy.
It's Mr. Mike Portnoy.
Hey.
Let's see.
Where are you?
There you are.
I guess I got to.
Well, I got the name right. That's the main thing.
Flying colors of Apollo, transatlantic, twisted system, metal allegiance. I guess I have to buy it.
This is funny.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, maybe we ought to get to the studio.
Yes, yes. You think?
Let's shop some more.
We're discussing the length of the album because we're at
50 minutes.
About 50 minutes now, and we haven't done the overture yet.
We know there's like at least two more songs we want to write.
Yeah, I want to do the Beatley thing, the
Rainbow Sky.
Yeah, and then, you know, I wanted to do the No Hope at All thing into that heavy guitar.
Probably, I would think we just want to follow the music where it wants to go and see where we land, right?
I think...
Let's not get
it's good to know this, but let's go in there and do
the crimson thing. Yeah.
No, I'm writing a Carol King song now.
I love Carol King. I know he had a sound.
Oh, well.
Yeah, right. That's what I was thinking of. Yeah, Pete's kicking around a verse kind of idea.
Something like that.
I'm still absorbing this. I mean, we just played the last few notes just a few moments ago, and the transatlantic ship moves so quickly that, and it was always this way for me.
Right? Yeah.
Like, I have to kind of just trust that. We got done, and I said, "Roine, do you think it's done? Is it? You know, because we move so quickly. Like, you had that idea for that slow end thing just a couple hours ago, and then we just dropped it in. That's a really important thing.
Yeah,
like,
it is.
Like the last thing that you're going to sing on an album, practically. We don't have the words, so it's a lot of kind of guesswork, but feel. Like, well, it feels like it's going to be good, and everybody kind of feels it out, and we do this chunk, and we splice it in, and then we go back to the other part. Okay, yeah, that feels good too, okay.
Concept, it would stay big the whole time. It would never come down to a quiet song.
Right, the quiet song would need to be earlier.
Yeah. Well, you did quiet on the acoustic.
Yeah, I played it quiet.
I think that can. I think we that orchestral thing that we just recorded, the big theme, uh-huh. is so big, it might be great to just take it home.
That would be the idea.
Yeah, let's take it home with a big version of this, with the modulations, and then ending back with the big theme and.
Sometimes when you spend this much time on an album recording, it just gets weird. You're getting sort of disconnected after a while. So it's been on and off. And then once you start working on it again, you get into it, you understand the music better. But it's a long time, and the music have taken, even after we left Sweden and we went back to our homes, the music have sort of continued to develop, you know, in its own way. So it's for me personally a kind of a strange way of making an album in such a long time, because it's almost a year between the track, the first songs, and the mix of the album. But it's interesting, you know. It's a new way. It's a different way of doing it, and each and everyone have lots of other stuff going on during the time, you know, even before the lockdown. So here we are with a new album 1 year later.
Right? No, like really? It was like, hey, is it going to be a double? Is it going to be a single? Where are you at? You know, yeah. I mean, just this morning, and we just wrapped the initial writing just, what, half an hour ago. And so it's been a ride.
That's true. Up until last night, until we went back to the hotel and saw the running time, we didn't know if it was a single or a double. I mean, right. To be honest, we were trying to keep it, or at least some of us were trying to keep it a single.
Yeah, so we put in some other parts and expanded some things, and then I wouldn't be surprised if in the overdubbing process we wind up expanding a little bit more, so we'll see what happens.
That usually happens, actually, yeah. Doesn't it, with this kind of music.
Just going to talk a little bit about the amps I've used for the recording. I think probably the main amp for this recording was the Orange amp and cabinet, a 30 watt TH30, twin channels, one dirty, one clean. Sometimes I use only the clean and put like a booster in front of that one.
Pete just said, I'm past caring, frankly. You get to that point, don't you?
No, I'm not.
I just want this torture to be over.
I'm not past caring. I'm just, you know,
yeah,
whatever we're going to do, I just want to do it.
Right. I just want the session to be
I just
over.
Know
Come on,
that
say it.
I'm gonna be sat on a, you know, I'm going to go on tour. Then I'm going to sit on a beach in Mexico for a week because I've got a week off.
Very nice.
And I'll be lying there thinking, if I hadn't taken this week off, I could be doing all this work on this other, you know, the transatlantic stuff.
Right.
But I can't say that to my wife because she'll be like, you're on holiday with me. Enjoy it.
Yes, that's right.
So in the end, we end up in Sweden in a studio, Studio Phoenix in Varnhem. To write the music, because we sent out the music, but we still don't know exactly what to record. So that's when we get together, we actually can start mapping out what the album will be. And somewhere along the line, I think that week or the 10 days we spent together, we were realizing we have a lot of material. So this is just growing and growing and growing. And into what we're thinking, oh, this has to be a double album. We've never done a double album with Transatlantic. We've done, I mean, pretty much packed albums and shows, but never a double album. So this is the first time. And we present it both as a double and as a more scaled down with a couple of different songs also, different mix. So it's the first time for a lot of things this time, and we're excited about it to see what the fans will dig.
It's interesting to see. I mean, of course, the thing with Transatlantic is more never is enough, and here we are now with our first proper double album. But I guess it was inevitable. I guess it was inevitable that Transatlantic would do a double concept album. Right?
I mean, it
was inevitable. There was no way to avoid it, I don't think.
Well, we tried to avoid it.
And we did. It wasn't our intention at all.
Certainly not my intention.
No. Yeah, it doesn't matter what path you take or the road you're on, because the flesh is strong. You're gonna have a thorn when it feels like it's totally hopeless anyway. Let the record play.
I'm here to talk a little bit about my guitars or some of my guitars that I used on the Transatlantic recording. It's actually a pretty inexpensive Mexico Telecaster thin line that I bought maybe 20 years ago. And then I've sort of pimped it with, most importantly, the true temperament fretboard. You can see this fretboard with the crooked frets.
Do you want like separate drums, bass?
Guitar? No, I think just a stereo mix of the instrumental music, a stereo mix and with the click track, a click stem, and then each of the vocals, so I could harmonize or double to any of them. It would be nice to have some separation if it's easy enough to make that.
Okay.
And then as soon as I get that, I could just start banging. I'll sing to the whole album, and then we could just pick and choose what we want.
When we sing harmonies, there's a lot of things where we all just put down what we think would work. There was a bit more thought in this album because we had to, you know, the lyrics had to be written and songs had to be sort of arranged vocally a little bit.
Months later, after finishing all the writing together in Sweden and everybody doing their tracks back at home, here we had this big 90-minute double album, and there began a discussion to possibly look at maybe we should consider cutting it down to a single album. And we went back and forth and back and forth, and certain members wanted it to remain a double, certain members wanted it to be a single. Not gonna point any fingers, but basically in true Transatlantic fashion, we decided, you know what? More never is enough. So we had the crazy idea, I think I suggested it actually, this crazy idea that was like an unprecedented idea. Why don't we just have two completely different versions? We'll have a full length 90 minute double album version, and then we'll also have a more abbreviated, more easily digestible length album as well. And it was a crazy idea, but everybody went for it. And it's not just like the short version is edited down. We're basically making two completely different albums. So some versions are going to have some people singing some parts, different lyrics, different singers, different musical passages that are in one version, not the other. So it's a crazy idea, but I think it just may work. It's just going to be a lot more work, and I think it is a lot of the reason why this record has taken so much time to make. We're essentially making two records, or really three different discs at this point. And that means not only writing different parts, recording different parts, but now Rich has to mix different parts as well. So it's a huge, massive undertaking, unlike anything I've ever heard of or seen. And I think it's, in true Transatlantic fashion, more never is enough.
Okay, this is classic. This is classic Neal. Oh, man. So I'm going through the short version. And I'm making notes for Rich, like, okay, cut from here to here. And so I'm going through the record, and I'm getting into the nearer to the end parts, and there's this Can You Feel It song. And I'm like, there's no new drums or bass or anything on this song. Oh, man. Oh, man. I don't think I told them about that song. I thought I sent it, but I don't think I did.
Okay,
a big day. What day is it? The 9th, July 9th, 2020. I just finished the rough mix of the edit of the shorter version of Transatlantic 5. And I'm pretty happy with it. It's been a lot of work. I've spent more than a week just rewriting and tweaking and re-singing and recutting and splicing and dicing, and it's very complicated. Anyway, it's a historic moment. I'm about to make an MP3 and send it to the guys. Yeah, we'll see what they say.
Hello, this is Rich Mauser here at the Mouse House, where I've been mixing the Transatlantic album for quite a while now. And this is an interesting project on this particular album because there's two different versions of this album. The same album, one edited down with some new material in it. So it's been a bit of a juggling thing to get these two albums to mesh together. This is the Pro Tools session here that I'm working with. And as you can see, I'm scrolling down and there's quite a few tracks on this. So I'm still scrolling, going down. This is a big one. I'm right to the end of my voices on Pro Tools, to where I can't put any more tracks on or it doesn't play.
Okay, so here we are in the very, very last phase of making an album. Writing the songs is the start of it, and the mixing is the last thing, together with all the graphics for the logotypes, the artwork, the layout of the album. So that's the fun stuff we're working with, these days. And it's a lot of work, you know. And as you know already, it's a big project. Actually, two albums in one, sort of. I think that Rich Mauser is working his butt off somewhere in California. And to make it sound great, and the mixes I've heard sound terrific, you know, very dynamic, great sound, very typical Transatlantic, I would say, representing all of us, the personalities. I think in the catalog, I would say it's a kind of a standout album, I think, and here we are, 1 year later. What started September last year.
I like to move it.